Thanks.
I'm a romantic. I love this country. I love Europe. I'm a European. I write about working class Americans who gave their lives and fought to liberate a place that I love deeply, with the bottom of my heart. But I'll tell you right now, I've traveled all over Europe and some parts of the world, and there's nowhere better to live than this community, Manchester, Vermont. And we know that. We know that because we have certain standards and we expect certain things from our communities. We expect them to support people. My son went to Burne Burton, which is the best school I can imagine ever sending your child to. It transformed him, and therefore I'm a very happy man, very happy resident of this community. I was asked by my editor a long time ago now to write a book about the greatest battle that you guys were ever in terms of numbers. Over 800,000 Americans were involved in the Battle of the Bulge. Here are a few of them. And if you look at this guy here, this is a guy called Vernon Leopold. And out of the blue, well, not out of the blue, he called me a couple of days ago. He's the last guy alive from 18. So this is taken in Camp Maxey in 1943. And he's over here. He's 93. He lives in New York. And he called me and said, thanks for the invite. I wanted to bring him here so you could meet him. And he said, thanks for the invite. I have one question for you, Alex. And I said, what? Am I the last one? And I said, well, there was a guy that slammed the door in my face in Arizona when I was interviewing every single member of the platoon who was still alive. And I haven't heard from him, but he was getting on a bit. But I do believe, Vernon, here, a Jew, an immigrant to this country in the 1930s, he fled fascism, fled Nazism. He is the last surviving member of World War II's most decorated platoon. It's the most decorated small unit. I interviewed several of these guys here. And I'm going to take you through a few slides. I'm going to try and be as evocative as possible. And then I'd like to answer a lot of questions, because I'm massively obsessed by World War II. And I think it would be great if you guys could tap into some of my wacky knowledge. I don't like to lecture for too long. But anyway, this is the... Oops, let's get this. We don't want to focus on this guy here because he's the enemy. This is Lau Bauck. Sadly, he passed away 18 months ago. And I have to say that I've interviewed a lot of supreme warriors, people that were very, very, very good at leading other men in combat. And he had the gentlest heart of all of them. Became a chiropractor after the war, and I sat for a week in his condo in, 2003. And every day he would be there at 11 o'clock in the morning, and we would finish at 4 in the afternoon, and he'd sit in his shorts and he would go through what had happened to him and his platoon. I did it for a week. There were some times when it was very painful for him. He went through an enormous trauma during the Second World War. And he was 20 years old on the 16th of December 1944. He was in control of an intelligence and reconnaissance platoon. That's an elite unit, the eyes and ears of a full infantry regiment. They were manning what was thought to be a dead zone, a quiet zone, on the Ghost Front in the Ardennes, just on the border of Belgium and Germany. Born in poverty, told me that one of his first jobs to help feed his family was as a was working on a golf course as a caddy. And he came back one day and he looked under his, I think that's, he's not calling me from heaven. He's not saying, Alex, you're wrong about that. He's fact checking me from up there. But anyway, he told me that he came home and he used to keep his tips from being a caddy under his pillow. And he came back and he found out that his dad had taken his tips, because his dad liked to have a little tipple. Gives you an idea of the background he came from. He joined the National Guard at guess what age? 13. And I have a photograph I can show you. I don't have it here, but it's in my possession, showing you as the proud member of a National Guard outfit. Selected by senior officers as a young man of enormous potential, excelled at officer training school, and found himself at 20 years old on the first day of the Battle of the Bulge, 16th of December 1944, in charge of 18 other guys. Only one guy was younger than him, a guy called Bill James, a corporal. So he had 17 guys who were actually quite a bit older than him in his platoon. SS Colonel Jochen Peiper, if you've seen the movie The Battle of the Bulge, the guy with the blonde hair, Rutgehauer, this is this guy. Now this guy is a genius of aggressive combat and warfare, nicknamed Blowtorch Peiper, because on the Eastern Front they didn't take prisoners. They went into villages and they burned them down. And they shot all the women and the children. If they were Jewish, they shot them in the back of the head while they were drunk on schnapps, and made ritualized that. But mostly in the Ukraine and on the Eastern Front, the SS didn't take prisoners and they destroyed everything in their wake. Blowtorch Peiper. That's why when the Russians came back in the spring of 1945, they raped and pillaged and destroyed in vengeance. You reap what you sow. And he reaped an awful lot of pain and suffering. He was trusted by Hitler, given the command by Hitler, that you're going to save the war for me. During the offensive in the Ardennes, you're going to take a Panzer Grenadier outfit, a Kampfgruppe Peiper, around 400 tanks, and you're going to smash your way through the Allied lines in the weakest, quietest spot, and you're going to go all the way to Liège, and you're going to separate the Canadians and the British in the north from the Americans, and they're going to be so panicked and in such a crisis that they're going to sit down and negotiate a surrender to finish this war. And then we'll turn our forces to the east and beat the Reds as they try and invade Germany. It's a big, big deal. Hitler's last gamble, they called it, the Battle of the Bulge. 200,000 men, he's the spearhead. He's the guy who's got to get there in 48 hours or the whole thing falls apart. Big pressure, big stakes. The biggest of World War II, I would say. Quickly, here's, you can't really see this very well because it's a terribly small map. But anyway, imagine this is Belgium, France over here, Antwerp and Liège up on the English Channel here, and this is the plan of attack. So Peiper will be the main arrow, the longest arrow. He's the main spearhead, one of several, but he has the most important job. He has to travel quickest to the target. Just above a small village called Lanzerath in Belgium, the INR platoon set up its position here. You can go to these foxholes, I'll show you photographs later, but this is these numbers on the boxes are the foxholes and the positions of the INR platoon. At 6 o'clock in the morning on the 16th of December 1944, there was the greatest barrage of World War II in Europe. These guys hid, cowered down in their foxholes, hands across their ears, while they endured the single heaviest barrage of World War II that Americans came under. We got pretty badly shelled in Anzio and many other places, but this was extraordinary, about an hour long. And then, around 8 o'clock in the morning, paratroopers, German paratroopers, who were the sort of shockwave that went ahead of Peiper, basically they were expendable. They were the ones to absorb the American fire, and then the panzers would come storming through after the Americans had been wiped out. Most of the German soldiers during the Battle of the Bulge were told that the Americans were half-breeds. They weren't warriors. They just needed a good kicking and they'd run. They were an immigrant army. They weren't the SS. They didn't have the cojones when it really came down to it. 8 o'clock in the morning, the paratroopers come along this road here, stomping along, ahead of the spearhead. And Lau Bauck and his men open fire. They kill maybe 30, 40, mostly with M1s, and they have two 50 caliber mounted machine guns. And that can do a lot of damage. They mounted it in a Jeep, they dug down and they put the Jeep down so that the range of fire was just above the earth. They opened fire, and then the Germans stupidly, really stupidly, decided to attack their positions. Attacked them once. 2 hours later, they attacked again. Full frontal assault. 1 o'clock in the afternoon on the 16th of December, after Lyle Balk had been given an order, a very, very important order, that would change his entire life. Hold at all costs. And he was given that order by his mentor, the guy that had chosen him to lead these men. He wasn't going to disobey. Hold your positions at all costs. And that's what he did. He carried out the order. 1 o'clock in the afternoon, Germans attack again. By now, it's thought that they've killed the Americans here, 18 of them, just 18, have killed maybe 200-300 Germans. You see the fence here. There's a fence there. Sorry, here, barbed wire fence. As they attacked from here, they would get to the fence, the barbed wire fence. They'd slow down, have to climb it. Single shots to the head. Single shot to the head. Don't waste ammunition. Single shot to the head. Bodies piling up so quickly along the wire that other Germans are taking cover behind dead Germans in front of them. It's one way to survive. Finally, late in the afternoon, as it's starting to get dark, around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, some smart guy among the Germans decides that maybe it isn't a good idea to have yet another full frontal assault at what they believed was not a platoon, but maybe even a battalion of 800 men. Maybe we go around the sides, maybe we outflank them, come through the woods and take their positions from behind. And as the light was fading, that's exactly what the Germans did. Now, in at least three or four of these positions, guys were firing literally until they had the last round, the last bullet, in the last clip of the last magazine. Before, a German would poke a Schmeisser machine pistol through the slit at the front of the dugout, say, raus, raus. So you either come out, or bingo, you're done. So a lot of these guys literally fought to the very last bullet. One of them who did so, it's a great picture by a guy called Tony Vaccaro. If you've seen the HBO documentary recently, Under Fire, this is a guy, Tony Vaccaro, worth checking out. Great photograph. He's the only guy I know that took amazing photographs that was actually an infantryman all the way through the campaign in Europe. So he was an artist photographer who was also a grunt, and he took amazing photographs because obviously he just didn't turn up and take a press shot. He was there every day, day in and day out. And that's one of his images from the Battle of the Bulge. Gives you a very good impression of what it was like for my platoon that day as Germans came towards them. Coldest winter in living memory in Europe. Now, in that dugout at the center of the position, you have 20-year-old Lyle Balk, and beside him is a 19-year-old, his runner, Bill James. And Lyle Balk comes out of the foxhole and he sprays some Germans. Got a tummy gun, gets back in, and Bill James says to him, did you get anyone? Did you get anyone? He said, I don't think so. Maybe, I don't know. Suddenly, at that moment, Lyle Balk sees the barrel of a Schmeisser machine pistol, this is a small machine gun, handheld machine gun, come through the front of the dugout. Instinctively, what would you do if I went like that? You do that. He pushes the barrel instinctively, boom, like that. The German opens fire. 47 bullets in Bill James's face. I'll show you a photograph later on. He was one of three of very, very seriously wounded Americans from this platoon. Amazingly, not one of them was killed. Three very seriously wounded. Remind me to talk about the cuckoo clock and the surrender later on. There's a cuckoo clock in this story, but I'm going to speed through a few more images. But remind me to come back to the moment at which Lyle Balk, who's 20 years old on this day, at the moment at which he turns 21, that he becomes an adult. My son's 20, he can't drink yet. He's got a fake ID, but he can't drink yet. I didn't say that, by the way. And I'm English, we started drinking at, well, my God, I won't go into that. 16, at least. Can I get this to, here we go. This is a National Archives shot, really nice National Archives shot of Americans taken prisoner, more Americans taken prisoner in the Battle of the Bulge. Massive crisis. You had, I think over 16,000 Americans died in the Battle of the Bulge. It lasted from the 16th of December 1944. Finally, we pushed the Germans back to their lines from where they attacked us at the end of January 1945. 800,000 Americans involved in some capacity at the front line or in support in the largest land battle you guys, I'm assuming you're mostly American, have ever fought in your history. Winston Churchill said in the Houses of Parliament at the end of the battle, "We must remember that this is a uniquely American victory." Montgomery, you know who Montgomery is, the big baddie, everyone hates Montgomery. I love him, I've met his son. But I'm British, I would say that, wouldn't I? And I like having cups of tea in the middle of combat and things like that. But anyway, that's another cliche about us in the war, which is true, by the way. You know, Montgomery had made a very dangerous statement in terms of his career in mid-January of 1945. He wanted to run the war, thought you guys didn't know what you're doing. He wanted to run the war, didn't like the fact that Eisenhower, Bradley, et cetera, Patton, who's my great hero, thought that he could do better. And he was in a press conference. He said, "Well, you know, I had to step in and tidy it up a little bit. I had to step in and work this one out for them." The Americans resented that with enormous anger. Can you imagine? 10th of July 1943, you guys start dying in Europe. Sicily, 10th of July 1943. By the time you get to here, December of 1944, you're into around about over 100,000 Americans dead in Europe by now. That doesn't compare to the Eastern Front, but it's still an awful lot. And three quarters of the young, mostly working class warriors who are dying are American by December of 1944. Three quarters of the Allied forces who are fighting and dying are American. Why? Because we hadn't got anybody left. You guys were running out fast, and you had Japan to finish off too. This had to come first. But we'd already run out. So let's get further on towards the end, and I can come back to the cuckoo clock. But anyway, here we go. The platoon were all taken prisoner. Everyone was taken prisoner, and this is Lau Bauck's dog tag. My wife took this photograph. Hammelberg is the Stammlager 13D. No longer a name, just a number in the vast gulag of the POW camps in the Third Reich. Now, to be a POW in 1942-43 was one thing, but to be a POW as Germany collapsed, as it starved, as it was bombed, that was quite a different experience. Kurt Vonnegut. We all know, hands up, who knows Kurt Vonnegut. I've never met him personally, but I interviewed him. He was in the Battle of the Bulge, Slaughterhouse 5. His great novel is based on his experiences in the Battle of the Bulge and then also in Dresden, where over 33,000 people were killed in 36 hours of terror bombing. I will call it terror bombing because that's a lot of people to kill for a lot of people, not me, but a lot of people would say with no good reason. Anyway, Kurt Vonnegut was taken prisoner. He was in the 106th Division, the division that actually suffered most casualties during the Battle of the Bulge and actually had more men taken prisoner than any other division in World War II, American division. When I interviewed him, he's very angry. He's kind of seemed like an angry guy. I've read other accounts. He's kind of an angry, depressed, kind of bitter guy. And he said that, you know, he started ranting to me about Tony Blair, who was the Prime Minister at the time. And he said, you know, well, I was so badly led. I spent a winter in a POW camp because we were told to surrender. We didn't want to surrender. We were ready to fight. He said, you can't imagine what it does to a unit's morale when they're told to surrender, when they're there ready to fight. But his commanding officers told him to surrender. So he finds himself on the 21st and 22nd of January, December 1944, almost 75 years ago, he finds himself on a POW train in a boxcar. And his boxcar is right next to my platoon's. So I interviewed him because I said, what happened when the British strafed you? When typhoons came low level and they strafed the POW train because there was no POW sign on the train. Germans had a big, you know, hospitality problem. All these guests of the Third Reich, and they didn't have enough trains to ship them to POW camps because they took so many prisoner. And he told me what happened. He said, well, you know, I'm standing there in a boxcar and the bullets are coming along the train and I can see light, you know, light from the holes in the roof. And guys are traumatized, they're terrified, and they're staggering, and they're going, if I stand under this one hole, what's the chance of a bullet coming through that twice? It's the mentality they're in, as people die around them. Anyway, he ended up in the same POW camp. Kurt Vonnegut's story is a different story. My POW, my guys in my platoon, all 18 of them, were sent into the Third Reich. Half of them were separated from the wounded. In fact, all the wounded were taken away to separate German hospitals. Miraculously, they survived. Bill James with 47 bullet wounds in his face, was operated on several times. Thought he was going to die many times. There he is there, look. Can you see his face? He committed suicide, sad to say, in the late 70s, before his unit was formally recognized. He had many, many operations, and finally, I'm done. Lyle Bauck told me, and Lyle's over here, he was in Hammelburg, POW camp, which is a very interesting story about Patton tried to rescue his own son-in-law, a guy called Waters, who was in Hammelburg, POW camp. Lyle joined the rescuers, tried to fight his way out of Hammelburg, was actually on the, not the lead tank, but the tank behind the lead tank as they tried to break out of Hammelburg, taken prisoner for a second time, brought back into POW camp. Had very, very bad food poisoning, hepatitis, and was literally, he told me, I was only a few hours from death. When my mentor, the guy that had selected me, who'd found out where I was, came in with a jeep into my POW camp in April of 1945, and came over to me at the end of a barracks, not just as you walk through the door, but walked all the way down the barracks and lifted me in his arms like the father I never had, and put me in a jeep and took me to hospital and saved my life. So for me, as a writer, as a narrator, to have a mentor save this boy, this 21-year-old, was an extraordinary, powerful, powerful part of the story. There's John Eisenhower. He actually, the great, I guess Roosevelt would have to come, I'd be biased, Roosevelt would have to come number one in the 20th century. Eisenhower, for me, would come number two as a great American and a president. Allied Supreme Commander, and that's his son there, John Eisenhower, who actually graduated from West Point, I believe, on June the 6th, D-Day, 1944. Anyway, he's a great historian, way better than me, John Eisenhower, and he wrote a really good book. It came out in the mid-60s, called The Bitter Woods, and it was the first really in-depth treatment of the Battle of the Bulge. And in the Battle of the Bulge, he mentioned the platoon. And he pointed out that had this platoon not held up the Kampfgruppe Piper, who were coming behind the paratroopers, those guys who were ahead, ones to be the sacrificial lambs, had they not stood and held, had they not carried out that order to the last bullet, stayed there and sacrificed and fought so hard, then Kampfgruppe Piper would have just kept storming on. In fact, Kampfgruppe Piper was held up for at least 12 hours by these guys. Lyle was taken to a cafe, the Cafe Schulzen in Lanzerath. He propped up Bill James, who was bleeding through his jacket and unconscious, and he looked at a cuckoo clock. I'm going to tell this part of the story, I have to. He looks up at a cuckoo clock in the cafe, and the minute hand is moving towards midnight. He told me, he's thinking to himself, when I was 15 years old, my aunt said to me, you'll never amount to anything unless you get straight. And he was in the National Guard, and he thought, I'm in the National Guard, maybe this will help. And she said, it'll be a miracle if you get to 21. But if you make it to 21, you'll have a long and prosperous, healthy life. And he sat there, 12 of his guys bleeding, shot, a guy here soaked in his blood, Bill James, there. And he sees a guy dressed from head to toe in black leather. It's like something out of a movie, because it really is an amazing moment. And it's Piper, the guy that's leading Kampfgruppe Piper. He walks into the cafe and he starts swearing in German. I can't swear very well in German. Scheißen, scheißen, scheiße. Dachshund, scheißend, whatever, doesn't matter. Anyway, he's annoyed. He's very, very angry indeed. this guy's got 48 hours and he's just lost 12 and he's hardly into Belgium. What the hell, he says to a German officer in the corner of the cafe, what the hell is holding me up? What's up there? And he says, there's an entire regiment up there, Colonel. Entire regiment. That's 1,000 guys. In fact, we know there were only 18. They can't move. It's darkness. It's not good. Bauk is sitting there looking at the cuckoo clock, and he sees this guy, Piper, leather cap, death's head skull of the SS on his cap here, young, angry, hungry. He knows everything's riding on the next few hours. And he sees Piper swear and shout and tell this German officer, send your men up there and check it out. Have you been up there? He said, no, we've not been up there. He said, get up there and tell me what's up there. Meanwhile, the hand clock, minute, boom, midnight. Lao Bao turns 21. And he told me that he felt this immense sense of release and relief. You know, at least I made it to 21. I don't care what happens now. I just got to try and stay alive. If I can stay alive, maybe my aunt will be right. And he felt this enormous sense of release, he told me. Anyway, that release turned to depression very quickly. It's very hard to describe what it's like to be a POW, having fought so hard, to be defeated, to be humiliated, to be a 21-year-old hotshot officer with great expectations. He's been in combat for one day, and he's got these great guys, this elite unit, shot up because he basically didn't turn tail and run. He carried out the mission. But in the back of his mind, he's thinking, the guy who's bleeding on my shoulder, maybe he wouldn't be bleeding if I hadn't done that. Maybe none of them would be bleeding. Maybe we wouldn't be prisoners if I just turned and run, which is what, I'm afraid to say, an awful lot of guys did on the first day of the Battle of the Bulge. Haunted, depressed, he thinks he failed. Gets saved by his mentor at the end of the war, comes back, wants to put it all behind him. Doesn't want to talk to anybody. Forget it. That was a black moment. I let my men down. They went through hell because I didn't make the right decision. I should have just gone to hell with it. Let's get out of here. Let's not fight to the last man and the last bullet. So let's wrap up now. Let's get towards the end. There they are. It's an amazing shot. I don't know whether you guys can see it. It fills me with great pride because I got to interview most of the guys here. This is the only one left alive. There's Lyle. This is Yankee Stadium, first day of the season. I'm not a Yankees fan, I don't think. Well, I've got to be careful here, haven't I? Because we have the Boston Red Sox. I guess probably third, anyway, getting distracted. Steinbrenner, who owned the Yankees, he found out about Bill James because Bill James pestered him. He said, do you realize who we are, what we did? This guy, John Eisenhower, he wrote this book called The Bitter Woods. He said that if it hadn't been for us, we wouldn't have won the Battle of the Bulge. We wouldn't have stopped Piper. The whole war would have been different. In fact, John Eisenhower made that argument that if it hadn't been for this unit and other small American units that did what they were ordered to do, which was to stand and fight and slow these guys down, then it would have been a very different outcome to that battle and therefore the war. Steinbrenner's like, wow, Bill James lives in New York State? He heard about it. He's like, that's an incredible story. It's a great story. He invited all of them to come first day of the season. Lyle threw the first ball. Is that the right terminology? Anyway. And their names, each of their names, were put up in lights in the stadium. So it's a beautiful ending to a very dramatic story, but basically what happened was that Lyle, coming back here, Lyle listened to Bill James and said, you know, I don't really want to go back into this, you know, and Bill James said, look, we did something amazing. We did something amazing. It was extraordinary. End of the story being that it was recognized by Steinbrenner, it was recognized officially by Congress and by the US military, and then, happily, here are all the families and the guys in the platoon, and this is when they were officially given their medals. 4 silver stars, 7 bronze stars with valor. actually Lyle Bout received the Silver Star twice. Bill James, sadly, not there. Took his own life before he finally saw the fruits of largely his efforts to have his comrades recognized formally to this day as the most decorated platoon, US platoon, of World War II. Really, under Carter this is, in the late 70s, and the reason for that is because of the significance of their action, the impact it had on the outcome of the battle and the war. And it also was emblematic, crucially emblematic, and very inspiring, because what these guys did was that they showed the Germans, we're not half-breeds, we're not gum-chewing guys from the, you know, the old world that they got rid of. We're warriors, we're strong, we'll beat you. You want to go one-on-one? Watch out. The psychological impact on the Wehrmacht of the American behavior, aggression, and toughness in the Battle of the Bulge collapsed their morale. They'd been told this is easy. They went up against these guys and they found out it was not easy at all. So it stopped, it took away a lot of their motivation after the war. Last picture, this is taken December the 16th, this last December the 16th. It's been a very snowy Christmas in Lanzarote. These trees here, all along these trees here, from this here, all the way along there, those are the positions of the platoon. And guess what? This is the same barbed wire fence across the middle. And here's the memorial to the platoon, the bench and the American flag. And what's lovely about this is that I've been back there several times. I've taken groups from the World War II Museum. I lead battlefield tours for the World War II Museum. I've taken groups back to the foxholes here. And I was very lucky 5 years ago to go back with the son of one of the platoons, a guy called Jim Fort. And this is Randy Fort here. I will send him a link to this wonderful cable program, and he'll be hopefully very happy to see this. And this is Randy, whose father was in the platoon, was a key member of the platoon, and he's taking back his family. He's keeping the story alive by taking his family back to show them where his father fought so hard. So I think that's me done. But I just wanted to add that you've been an absolutely fantastic audience. I hope I've not bored you, and thank you for being here so much. It's as I said before, it's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful community. Thank you. If you look at the bulge in the Allied lines, so when Piper hit, when those prongs of the Wehrmacht hit, they created a bulge in the Allied lines, literally just a bulge. So that's why it's called the Battle of the Bulge. I think it's a particularly unimaginative title for an amazing battle, but that's the Battle of the Bulge, yeah. 70 miles, they penetrated 70 miles in about 36 hours, and then Piper was stopped. You've got to imagine this guy's driving massive panzer tanks down very narrow roads. I mean, roads that we drive around all the time, but in a very, very large panzer tank, it's very difficult. You only have to stop one of those, and you've got a big traffic jam behind because you can't take over. So famously, you have there's a book called The Damned Engineers. In about 20 miles after Lanzarote, on the 18th of December, Piper was finally stopped because the engineers, American engineers, blew up a last bridge. He couldn't go any further. You know, he tried this bridge, tried that road, tried this bridge, whatever, and we got there first. And he had one last bridge. And if he could cross that bridge, he could get to Liège, he had a chance of completing the mission. And the engineers blew it up as his tank came down. It's the scene in the movie, I think. It's true. And Piper was stood in the turret of the tank. And as the bridge went up, boom, slapped his... He wasn't a Prussian. He wasn't an Aryan. He was an Aryan, but he wasn't a Bavarian. But anyway, he slapped his thigh, and he said in German, "The damned engineers," which is the title of the book. But anyway, long answer to your question. But,
we have a question.
Sorry, yep.
Hi, I'm a little obsessed with the Battle of the Bulge as well. My dad was in the Battle of the Bulge. He was in the 3rd Armored Division.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And I was just curious, how did these guys fit in? Because my dad came in like D-Day plus 30 or something, and then he went all the way through Belgium, through Malmedy, to Houffalize and all that. So how did these guys get to where they were?
Good question. They didn't come until September 1944. Okay. So they came straight in, and then they came through into Belgium, and then they went on the line, I think, in the late November. They did a bunch of patrols, and then they were actually in that position in Lanzerath in the first week of December. And they thought they weren't going to see any action. They thought, you know, this is the Ghost Front, it was called. Very, very long Allied line that goes from, you know, basically the North Sea and Holland all the way down to the Alps. And it was known as the Creepy Corner, you know. It was a place where there were noises at night that would keep you awake if you were patrolling. Don't eat the yellow snow. But it was not a place they expected to see combat. These guys were very annoyed because they were supposed to be mobile. They were intelligence and reconnaissance platoon, lightly armed. They're supposed to be highly mobile, and they're supposed to scout out and observe the enemy. And in fact, on the 14th and 15th of December, they did their job brilliantly, and they said, "We can hear tanks. We can hear the Germans. They're up to something. This is not normal." And they sent the order up the line, and it was ignored. So really, the Battle of the Bulge begins with the largest intelligence failure, you could argue, in US history. I mean, certainly the World War II. How do 200,000 Germans suddenly attack you and you don't know about it? You're taken completely by surprise. So, anyway. Yep.
I find it extraordinary that the Germans treated them so well as POWs that same war, particularly after what they've done to the Germans. So can you comment on how the Germans were to be so inhuman on the Middle Eastern front?
Well, it's interesting. It's a good question. Why were these guys treated quite well? Well, we treated them very well. I mean, you know, the Germans, we dropped leaflets on them and said, look, give up. Because if you give up, we'll treat you well. And the Germans actually knew that we did treat them very, very well. The Germans that came over to POW camps in the US were treated better than a lot of people in the US at the time. I am not joking. I was told by a veteran in Mississippi that he went to a movie, Gone with the Wind, I think it was, I can't remember, in Mississippi in 1943, and the blacks had to be up here in the gods, and the German POWs were sitting there nearer the screen. That's how well they were treated. So, Laos, one of the platoon in Laos, one of the guys in Laos platoon, told me that he knew that the war was really near an end, and he knew that it was wrong to hate his captors and the German people because he saw a guard crying as he tried to eat the last crumbs of a piece of bread or an old moldy potato. So he realized that they're suffering just like us. The German people are suffering just like us. At least we're getting a Red Cross parcel. Sometimes the Germans withheld the Red Cross parcels, but most POWs did get regular deliveries of Red Cross parcels, which kept them basically alive. So, good question. If you were Russian, you're basically shot, you're done. You know, very, very few Russian POWs went back to Russia after the war. Same with the Germans that were taken prisoner in Russia by the Russians. You see these amazing photographs. If you Google it, it's like 1954, and you see these POW trains of German POWs, the few thousand from hundreds of thousands that come back to Germany. So some of these guys are married, and it was 1943 when they were taken prisoner, and it's now 1954, and their wife's still waiting for them at Hamburg or wherever, whatever station. The Eastern Front was a very, very different, very, very different war. Germans knew that if they treated us relatively well, we would treat them relatively well. There was a mutual respect. The fact that Lyle told me that he was amazed that they weren't all shot on the spot when they were taken prisoner. He said he was amazed that when the SS came in, when Piper was there, that they didn't get shot by him. Piper did shoot a lot of people after that. In fact, on the 17th of December, he had the next day, Piper goes ahead and some of his guys, again, being slowed down, a Panzergrenadier unit, and they commit the worst atrocity of World War II, Malmedy massacre. That's about 10 o'clock in the morning, I believe, around about then, on the 17th of December, 10 miles or so from Lanzerath, Piper's guys take around about 120 Americans and they just machine gun them. I interviewed a guy that survived. He told me that the way that he survived was that two guys were shot and they were lying on top of him. And then he heard the sound, "Macht alles kaputt, macht alles kaputt." Kill them all, finish every one of them. And the SS came through, and if they saw breath in the cold air, bang, back of the head. And he said there was a guy, there was a guy above him and a guy above that guy, and the guy on the top was squirming and he was crying out in pain, bang, shot. Bullet went through him, went through the guy above him, and then went into his thigh. And he said, I don't know how the hell I didn't scream out in agony, but if I had, I'd have died. And a guy called Bill Merrickan, no longer alive, came from Bedford, Virginia, which I was very interested in talking to him because I wrote a book about the Bedford boys. There's 19 guys from this one community that were killed on Omaha Beach. But yeah, so yeah, the SS did commit atrocities. We didn't take a lot of them prisoner at the end. You know, when we got into Germany, and they still kept fighting, and they were killing more and more and more of us. You know, in January of 1945, over 70,000 Americans were killed. Sorry, became casualties in the European theater, and just in January, that 1 month alone. If you look at the casualty figures for 1944 and 45, both in the Pacific, but particularly in Europe, from D-Day onwards, it just soars. We're talking about mass industrial slaughter towards the end. February, March, April of 1945, 350,000 Germans killed in each month. Almost a million, some would say more than a million Germans killed in just 3 months at the end of the war. So things got a little bit, you know, Piper on the Eastern Front, Blowtorch Piper, they would have a joke, they'd have a saying that, you know, they used to have a little bit of rabats, you know, a lot of fun after you had quite a bit of schnapps. And rabats means it's slang for having a laugh. Now, having a laugh on the Eastern Front meant shooting people, you know, killing them. You know, knock on the door, they come out, doesn't matter. Piper's guys did that along the route after Lanzerath. And they were tried after the war at Dachau, fittingly, oldest concentration camp. First one that Hitler founded, 1933, for his political enemies. Liberated on the 29th of April 1945 by a guy that I interviewed, Felix Sparks, the liberator. And Piper was tried at Dachau, and he was found guilty. And he actually said to the prosecutors, don't hang my men. I'm their commanding officer. Hang me. They were just being good soldiers. They were carrying out their orders. We've all heard that before. He said, kill me, hang me, make me the sacrifice. But these guys were just doing their jobs. For various reasons, I don't want to go into it too much, Piper got away with it. He didn't hang. But in 1976, before the war, he'd been very close to Himmler. Those of us who know about the Holocaust know that Himmler was one of the prime architects, if not the most determined bureaucrat of the Holocaust. And in the 1930s, Piper had been his aide. And they talked and dreamed and thought, you know, let's have a Valhalla. Once we've conquered Europe, we're going to have one area of Europe that's just going to be purely Aryan, just for us and the SS diehards, the pure of the pure. And it was just in an area of France, just not far from the Vosges. And Piper went to work for Porsche as their PR manager. I believe it was their PR manager. He did very well after the war. I think served less than 10 years of a prison sentence for what was done. The Malady Massacre, namely, was the main crime. Left-wingers, communists in France, found out that he'd been working for Porsche. He was fired. French Resistance, veterans of the French Resistance, the French, like, what's he doing with the job? He's a war criminal. Why isn't he in jail? And so he was fired from several jobs, and he basically then went to this small village, which is where he'd intended to have Valhalla. And he bought a country villa. On Bastille Day, the great French day, a bunch of local youths who'd found out that he was living there, they went there with petrol bombs, and they threw him at his home. Piper had sent his family away because he knew he'd received death threats, but he wasn't going to run. Come on, then. And the story is, and it's true, I believe, is that as his house burnt, he forgot that his signed copy of Mein Kampf was upstairs. And he goes upstairs, and when he's upstairs, the roof collapses. And they found him, and he was about that big, it's a piece of charcoal. Piper.
Sorry. World War II is your passion, and I'd like to know two things. Why is it your passion, and are there things that you learned through your work that you think would be helpful in understanding what's happening to us today?
Wow. That's an awesome question. It's one that, if I was to answer really, really honestly, would tear me up, because I have to say that I go back to these places 6 or 7 times a year, often with the World War II Museum, with groups of people, and I go to Omaha Beach every June the 6th. I was there at Dog Green Sector, 6:32 a.m., D-Day. I think 112 guys were killed in a distance between me and the end of that library there. Bloodiest sands in US history. And I think to myself, you know, I'm a European. I remember going to France for the first time and falling in love with it when I was 10 years old. I have spent a lot of some of the happiest times of my life in Europe. I can sit in a cafe in Paris and look around me at that beauty, that the preservation, or rather the restoration of civilization, of democracy, of sophistication, of all the values that we really deeply, deeply hold dear. Barbarism was defeated in that country. It started with those kids, those working class kids that gave their lives on Omaha Beach, or in Sicily, or in North Africa, and here in the Battle of the Bulge. Europe was liberated, absolutely liberated, saved, mainly towards the end of the war in Western Europe by Americans. So I think that that's something that I feel very passionately about. My son's an American, my wife's American, and I'm kind of half, I've been here long enough to feel that I maybe belong in the middle of the Atlantic somewhere. But I have to say that I don't think there's a story that means more to me, that's more significant, more moving, and more powerful than the idea of the good American. Not the ugly American, the beautiful American. The young American that fought with passion and righteousness, that followed a great leader, and did so much, accomplished so much, that gave me the Europe I grew up in and that I love. So I think that's part of it. My grandmother, my mother's father was killed in World War II. And she grew up in the shadow of not having a father, and it affects her to this day, and therefore, in some way, it's affected me. So that is part of it too. What can we learn? When you see fascism, kill it quickly, fast. Do not let it breathe. Sorry about that, but my pleasure. No, what happened was that he got trench foot. He got very, very bad. It was a serious condition. In fact, at one point, it was really debilitating for the US Army. They didn't have the right equipment. A lot of them didn't change their socks often enough, whatever. And they were, you know, in wet foxholes. Imagine being out there night after night right now in this weather. You've got to be really, really careful not to get it. So he was taken off the line, I think, on the 12th of December, just 4 days before. And I think to this day, well, I know to this day that he feels like a sense of guilt, survivor's guilt, that he wasn't there that day, that he didn't get to fight with those guys. And I said to him, you know, well, it's a good job you didn't get to fight with them because you're Jewish. You know, being captured by the Germans as a Jew, it might not have ended up being, they all used to throw their dog tags away because they had the Jewish, they were identified as Jewish, so the first thing they did was throw your dog tags away. But the SS would come along and say, where are your dog tags? You're Jewish. Be careful, you know?
So what led you to choose the INR platoon to be the people you were going to write a book about?
Well, what I try and do, because it's such a massively complex battle, you know, it's a vast area, it's very difficult to get your head around it. I read lots of books and I was just confused, you know? So many people, so many things happening. So my editor said to me, can you do kind of what you did in the Bedford Boys, where you just chose one small group to try and humanize it? I mean, the ideal thing is to have like a soccer size, a football team size of guys where you can actually really root for them and get to know some of them individually. So he said, can you find a small group of guys who epitomize what the Battle of the Bulge was all about? You know, stand and hold, fight, have have that oomph in you. And I called up a guy at the Eisenhower Center in New Orleans, a guy called Michael Edwards. Thank you, Michael. I changed my life with the tip. And I said, hey man, you know, is there a unit? Is there a bunch of guys I could write about? Like one small group of guys, like a platoon, and you know, even a company's 200 guys, but a platoon is 18 to 30, you know. It's one group of guys that are right at the heart of the action. You just follow them and you get the whole picture. And he said, yeah, here's Lyle Bout's number. INR platoon is still alive. It's a great story. I was like, okay. And I phoned up Lyle. Literally an hour or two later, because I was like, ooh, here we go. I'm a journalist at heart still. And I thought, this has got the makings of a good story, you know? And I was also like, I could call my editor back within a couple of hours and say, hey, I got it. And I called up Lyle and he said, yeah, you can interview me, absolutely. But you have to interview everybody else in the platoon too. So I'm like, okay. And I said, how many of them are there? He said, 12, and I'm not the star. If you make me the star, I'm not going to cooperate. This has to be about my whole platoon. So come back to me when you've interviewed a few of them, and I'd love to meet you and talk to you. And I spent the next 7-8 months going all around the US, tracking down every single one of these guys that I could find that was still alive. And only one guy said no, and he actually talked to me on the phone. Because I turned up in Mesa, Arizona, and I knocked on his front door. The neighbor had told me 3 hours earlier he doesn't get up till midday. So I'm like, okay. Came back at midday, knocked on the door. I said, Mr. I don't want to mention his name, but anyway, in case he might be the one that could be still alive. Anyway, very nice guy. And I knocked on the door and I said, we were supposed to have an interview today. And he said, I wrote you a couple of days ago. And it turned out that while I was away going around interviewing people, my wife had received a letter saying, no thanks, don't come. And I'm like, well, I'm on your doorstep, you know. And he said, I don't want to talk about it. I hate what I went through. I'm not going to talk about it. It's the most painful part of my life. I'm not interested. And he said it was a goddamn stupid thing they did, make us stand and hold that position. I didn't need to go to a PLW camp. We should have just turned and gone, like everybody else did. That was the sensible thing to do. Then I wouldn't have had to go through what I went through. So anyway, I said, look, I've come all this way. You're the only guy I haven't interviewed. This is a great story. I need to hear from you. And I just stood there. And he said, okay, call me in a week and I'll talk to you. And I called him in a week and I talked to him for like an hour on the phone. So I think that answered the question. Did it answer the question? Maybe I rambled yet again. Anyway, sorry. Did you guys hear the question? We're talking about why people didn't. I mean, I guess I would actually now be talking about a lot of your parents, wouldn't I? Hands up whose parents served or were in World War II. Wow. Huh. So the question is, why didn't they talk about it? Well, I'm sure some of them did talk about it, but let's have another. This is very, very, very interesting. Hands up if your parent was in World War II and didn't really talk about it. Yeah, or father-in-law, or people that you knew. I mean, well, as one guy said to me, 5 minutes of combat was like the worst car crash you can imagine being in your life. And I was in a car crash every day for 511 days. That's why I don't want to talk about it. And when I came home, the only thing I dreamt of, the only thing that was pure among the death and the evil and the blood and the stench, was the image of my wife. So when I came back, the last thing I was going to do was poison that with the truth. I certainly wasn't going to tell her what I had become, which was a cold-blooded killer. I wasn't going to tell her what had been done to me. I wanted to put it all behind me. So some of them started talking when they got drunk in a corner at the Holiday Inn in 1978 or 77 or 1980, and their buddies were there again for the first time, and they felt comfortable, and they were retired, and they had a few too many whiskies, and they started to talk. And I've been at those events, I've seen people share, but it wasn't until a lot longer afterwards, after the war. So, trauma is what you're talking about when you talk about war. You're talking about people killing each other. It's about killing quickly, effectively. You know, there's the Royal Marine, they're actually a commando, number 4 commando, Cockney. What? What? And he was interviewed, and he was on the first wave, Sword Beach, D-Day, under Lord Lovat, a great aristocrat warrior, beautiful man, great historian. 34 years old, character in a book I'm writing about now. And the guy underneath him is a 19-year-old working class kid. He's like, oh, right, it's from London, like, you know? London, Cockney. And the guy interviewed him recently, he said, "What? You know, how did you use the knife, the famous commando knife?" He said, "Well, you take a knife like this. You don't do that. You grab the bleeder, you grab the kraut, and you pour him on gently. Put the knife through the ribs." This is what we're talking about. People trained to kill. It's about killing people. So they don't want to talk about it. They didn't want to talk about it. It's unseemly. It's not nice to talk about how you kill people without them shouting out effectively, you know. So, yeah. I interviewed a bunch of guys that were liberated Dachau. And one of them was in a hotel room. And I had to leave the room. It was the only time I left the room when I was interviewing a veteran, because I went outside to cry. It's the only time just I lost it. And he told me that he'd had such bad PTSD that one day his wife, he woke up in a cold sweat in the morning. It was like 20, 30 years after the war. And she's shaking him awake in nightmares. And he told me that, you know, he asked her, "Have I done this a lot?" This is the first time he realized that he'd been woken by his wife. And she said, "Well, the first 15 years were pretty bad, but the last 10 haven't been too long." True story. So, you know, like one of the Bedford people, one of the people in Bedford, the sister, a sister was working on a ward in Lynchburg, and her brother came down she was working on a ward, and she saw him come through the door, and they said it was a beautiful day, it was sunlight, bleached with sunlight, and she saw her brother come along, and she didn't think she'd ever see him again. It's a Bedford boy, fought in Omaha Beach. And he came over to her, and she dropped everything, and she turned to the sister and said, "It's my brother." And he came over to her, he didn't say a word, he held her, and he said, "You have to go home with me. I can't go home alone. I left our brother in France. I can't face mum and dad without you, my sister." So these are, you know, we're talking powerful moments of people. But she said to me, the sister said to me, "People think that the heroes are the ones that went over there and died, and they fought, and they were." She said, to her, the greatest heroes were the ones that went over there, saw people die, and they fought, and then came back and had to live with it for the rest of their lives. There's a certain, I think there's an incredible beauty to that strength of character that a lot of people were broken by World War II. They were broken when they came home. But to be broken and then carry on, that's a very, very noble thing. To not inflict your pain, your suffering, to hide it and to carry on, to soldier on, to try and keep your family together, try not to drink too much, try not to beat your wife, try to be a good person. That was a big struggle for a lot of those guys, the ones that went, "Oh, eh?" day after day. You're not the same when you come back. So I've always been inspired most by the battle after the war to stay human, to stay sane, to stay gentle, you know? Anyway, thank you. The unconditional surrender was a big deal in World War II. It was agreed at Casablanca conference, and Roosevelt and Churchill discussed it, and Churchill was kind of dismayed by the idea that you would tell the Germans, "You have to, there's no negotiation here. You surrender unconditionally. We just tell you what the hell we want you to do, and you do it." Now, Churchill believed that would maybe prolong the war, that you could maybe end the killing and the suffering earlier if you got the Germans to a point where they were weak enough to be able to maybe have Rommel. Sadly, in a way, Rommel, you know, he took his own life because he was linked to the July plot in 1944. Rommel was the guy we could have maybe negotiated with that we wanted to maybe do a deal with at the end. But point is that we had unconditional surrender. Now, imagine if Piper had got to Liège. Imagine if he had split the Americans and the Canadians from the British and the Canadians from the Americans. They're not getting on very well anyway. This war's been dragging on a long, long time. Eisenhower has told the American public and Roosevelt and others and Churchill that the war's going to be over by Christmas. Now, you're an American and your son's just being killed in the Battle of the Bulge, and this war's been going on for a long, long time, and they told you it was going to be over, and suddenly the Germans are back on the English Channel. It's like, Politically, it would have been a very, very serious crisis. There'd been a lot of problems politically. So I don't think, no, this wasn't going to in any way win the war for the Germans, but it could have changed the last chapter. There could have been a possibility that the Germans could have negotiated, that unconditional surrender may have been dropped, that the political situation would have been such that people would have said, okay, let's call it, this is a stalemate, we don't want this to carry on any longer. I don't know, it's possible, but unlikely. Certainly Hitler would have had a much stronger negotiating hand. He would have had a hand. He would have had some kind of leverage. But from the very beginning, most of those involved in the operation, senior German officers, thought it was hopeless. It was a desperate last gamble. It was crazy. But they carried it out. And Piper certainly was determined to succeed. You know, he wasn't going to let anything stop him. So yeah, a desperate last gamble, very written off by the people that were smart in Germany before it even began. But could have made a difference, a little bit of a difference at the end. Anyway, I'm sure that you guys are kind of exhausted by now and would I'm very happy to answer any other questions at some other time, but you've been a great audience. Thank you for your attention, and it's been fun. Thanks.